we kick off the second half of our podcast season with our first live recording with the packed house at Stardust Video and Coffee in Orlando, Florida. We celebrate our third anniversary with the first in the Midnight Marauders Story Hour series. For this show, we bring to the stage four of Florida's most brilliant writers for a live reading. And of course, they all take turns in the hot seat chair. Brianna Johnson, Vulgar Geniuses alum Michelle Lizet Flores, Kayla Kumari Upadhyaya, and Ryan Rivas join us on the stage. Grab your favorite cup of joe and get settled in for an hour of the Vulgar Geniuses podcast live at Stardust. Are you currently looking for a bookstore that has a great selection of books? Well, Kizzy's Books and More is that bookstore. Visit www.kizzysbooksandmore.com to purchase your next book for our book club. Use coupon code VulgarGenius to receive 10% off the subtotal of your first order. So glad to have you here for our very first live recording of the Vulgar Geniuses podcast. Tonight is going to be a fun-filled night. We got music. We got DJ Rubots on the ones and twos. Give it up for him. And we have four brilliant writers who will be stepping up to the stage this evening. We are utterly amazed that they said yes to our emails and that you all said yes to them to coming out to hear them read. This is extremely important and we're so glad to have you here.
Yes, so very, very thankful because this is our first live recording since the pandemic. And we're very excited. We've been dreaming of this night for so long, and we have very, very, very talented writers that would be gracing the stage reading to you all tonight.
That's right. We have four writers. Their names are Brianna Johnson, Michelle Lizet Flores, we have Kayla Kumari Upadhyaya, and the Ryan Rivas. We are so grateful again to them coming up. Give them a round of applause. Yes, 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 yes. Now, I know we just did this whole spiel and we told you that we were here to hear people read, but the truth of the matter is I lied. This is actually a speed dating event. The numbers that you have, we'll be calling them and you will be switching tables.
Look at
them
to see who's matched
with
who.
So just look around, see who you're interested in, though, really. But we're going to get this night started with our very first guest. I want you all to
please welcome to the stage, Brianna Johnson.
Now, this is not your typical, reading event. Like we said, this is a live recording. So our guests are going to get a mini interview before they start.
Yes.
All right, so I'm going to give you this mic.
You know, it's a little getting to know you portion for everybody that came out to see you.
All right.
So we have stalked you in your Instagram. Your next Halloween costume going to be?
I've already planned Sally Bowles from Cabaret.
Ooh.
I work. Yeah.
All right. The next question is, you are an avid AMC Oscar screener.
Yes, I am.
Yep. I didn't even know. Did y'all know this was a thing that you all could go to AMC and they give you this fancy pass and you could watch all the Oscar nominated films? Is there a movie or an actor that you felt was denied winning an award?
So many.
Is there one in particular that stands out?
Oh, modern or old?
It's up to you.
I'll start old. Butterfly McQueen in Gone with the Wind.
Oh.
She should have been nominated and won.
Mm.
I will say Gene Wilder and Willy Wonka in the Chocolate Factory. I stand by that. I hear, like, that was questionable, but watch it again. Let's see.
Abraham said, come with me.
Yeah.
And you'll sing.
I'll spare you the singing. Let's see. I'm trying to think modern. Amy Adams deserves something.
Yeah.
Right? Something. I can list Arrival, right? She wasn't even nominated for Arrival. So Amy Adams for anything.
She's that girl that's just like an everybody movie.
Right? And she's always good.
It's always the other person that feels like they get right. the... Yeah, right. I feel that. Yeah.
She does all the work.
Yeah.
And our last question for you is, what makes Brianna Johnson want to write a piece about something?
Lord. I think it's best for everyone that I write something. Because, you know, mental health.
Yes.
It's a thing.
Yes.
And I find I'm a better person to be around when I've written something. So, yeah.
Amen to that.
Yeah.
I agree. And now with, we now present to you Brianna Johnson, ladies
All right.
and gentlemen.
Put your hands together.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
All right, so I write flash fiction, so I have two little stories for us tonight. And before I read those stories, I like to invoke a name that gives me confidence, and that name is Beyonce. So indulge me for a moment with Beyonce. Okay, all right, she's with us now in spirit, so it'll go well. So. Right. So the first story I have is called The Falling Man. No one was sure who first noticed him. Some believed it was a passenger on a red eye from California to New York, his body flying past their window. Others said an ornithologist spied him through her binoculars while studying the flight of a green heron. The story of a farm girl in Wichita also made the rounds. She spotted him from the roof of her treehouse. This account was popular amongst evangelical crowds, as it was said she stayed on the roof and prayed for his safe passage. The falling man was broadcast on every channel, his flailing limbs and distorted features visible throughout the nation. News teams sent up helicopters and drones to hover about him as he fell. Anchors tried to question him, skydiving with their microphones outstretched. Airplanes with banners asking why and who are you crowded the airspace. The man never answered, his mouth open in a silent scream. He kicked like a roach on its back. He never gestured or signed to the cameras for help, merely grasped at the air as it roared by. No one intervened. They didn't even try. People stood on their lawns and looked skyward. Watch parties gathered in open fields with beach chairs and coolers, shielding their eyes as they tried to catch a glimpse of his helpless frame. It was as if he was falling over the entire country, his shadow cast across every state and city street. Yet years later, when asked what he looked like, no answer was the same. Those in the Midwest were certain he had a beard, thick and brown, that covered a pale white face. They talked about the whites of his eyes. On the West Coast, they swore he was a blonde with a tan. They talked about his toothy smile. The South saw sunburnt skin that peeled on his cheeks and nose. He was bald. And in the East, people saw a black man with locks that whipped the air. He was pigeon-chested and thin. However, all accounts said he was barefoot, the bottoms of his feet cracked and bleeding. These images of the man soon appeared on T-shirts in Times Square. Artist renderings were peddled and painted on the sides of buildings. A man in Fort Worth claimed to have a piece of the falling man's hair. He said he found it in the branches of an oak. It sold for $2,000. A woman in Duluth found an image of the falling man in an oil stain on her driveway. It was soon outlined by votive candles. A priest was called to consecrate the blot. People gathered in pews and temples. New churches sprouted across the nation under tent poles, crude images of the falling man staked into the ground. As time passed and the man still fell, others grew wary. They feared he was a visitor from another world or a weapon of mass destruction. The White House issued a statement to reassure the masses gathered outside its gate. We are closely monitoring the situation. Day passed into night and the man still fell. As with all things, people eventually grew bored. They returned to their homes, churches closed their doors, the networks gave way to more conventional fare. The 90-year-old man won the Mega Millions. A boy in Denver shot up his school. The Dow dropped 3 points. The next day, people went to work, kids went to school, planes whirred overhead, no one checked the skies. Now, when asked, no one seems to remember where the man landed, or if he even landed at all. So I have a second and final story for you all, and I thought I would invite you to a wedding in this story. And you're going to hear from some of the guests at this wedding. So this wedding, or this story, is called A Plantation Wedding. The ancient oaks that line the walk will be trimmed with fairy lights. The white bride in her white dress will stand beside her white groom and smile wide with white teeth as they post her pictures on the lawn. The photographer will tell them to hold each other, kiss. It's the happiest day of their lives. Bridesmaids and groomsmen will watch and applaud, dressed in hoop skirts and waistcoats, pictures of the genteel South. We will watch from the eaves. In the kitchen, the staff of Miss Maybell's soul food and catering service will sweat over steaming trays of okra and yams, collards and cornbread, macaroni and cheese, finger-licking food served on silver platters by black hands and white gloves. The wait staff will glare from the kitchen as guests mingle in the parlor on the refurbished hardwood floors. They will admire the craftsmanship. These old homes were so well built. Others will tour the grounds escorted by guides. They will tell them about the estate, how the fields once burst with cotton and sugarcane reached the sky. We will listen from the soil. The guides will take guests to the quarters, burned black cabins with no doors and dirt floors. The guests will run their hands along the walls lined with mud and paper clippings. They'll be surprised to see them still standing, as if the same damn hands didn't build the manor. The cabin will be decorated, set dressing for the show, a bed in the corner, a rocking chair, a pot in the fireplace. The guests will find it quaint, cozy. We will watch from the corners of the room. We will remember hay and mites and cold. We will know the pot was always empty. Inside the master's house, we will watch from the walls, watch our kin shuffle in and out again, still burdened. In the kitchen, we will wipe the sweat from our kinfolk's brows. We will marvel at the whites of their eyes. We will spit the ashes from our hollowed mouths into the pots that simmer and hiss. We will try to force knives into our family's clenched fists and tell them to fight. The party will move from the house to the lawn. Stomachs full, the guests will dance and drink and laugh. They will rejoice in each other and the beauty of their lives. The bride will throw her bouquet. Rice and rose petals will rain down. She and her groom will ride away beneath the bowed boughs toward a shining future. Along the tree line and woven amongst the branches, we will witness and weep. Thank you.
The way you blowing up my phone won't make me leave no faster. Put my coat on faster, leave my girl no faster. I should've left my phone at home, cause this is a disaster. Calling like a collector, sorry I cannot answer.
That was fire. Thank you so much, Brianna. Again, one more for Brianna Johnson.
Sometimes I feel like I live in Grand Central
Station. Yeah. These writers did not come to fucking play. Do you all hear me? They did not. I think this floor is on fire. She has scorched the earth with those words. That's how you start this night.
Before we go on, you know, I made the faux pas because I was just so excited. I totally forgot to tell y'all who Brianna was. I mean, she told y'all who she was with her words, but I'm going to read off her credentials, okay? Brianna Johnson's story has appeared in Cosmonaut Avenue, Gigantic Sequins, The Molotov Cocktail, Wigleaf, Kenyan Review, Obsidian Literature and Arts in the African Diaspora, Split Lip Magazine, and elsewhere. She is an alum of the Tin House Summer Workshop. She is a two-time Pushcart Prize nominee, O. Henry Prize nominee, and Best Small Fictions nominee with work long listed for the Wigleaf Top 50. She is also an MFA graduate from the University of Tampa, and she teaches college English in Orlando, Florida. This is a gift. Thank you. So who's our next
guest? So this next person has a personal connection to me because I found her because I work with her sister. So our next guest is none other than Michelle Lizet Flores. She's a graduate of FSU and NYU Creative Writing Programs. She currently works as a teacher and co-hosts the What's in a Verse Poetry open mic in Jacksonville, Florida.
Let them know, okay?
She has previously been published in magazines and journals such as the Miami Rail and the Travel Latina, a finalist for the Juan Felipe Herrera Award for Poetry. She is the author of the chapbooks Cuentos from the Swamp and Memoria, as well as the picture book Carlito the Bat Learns to Trick or Treat. Her short fiction can be found in the forthcoming anthology Places We Build in the Universe through Flower Song Press. Please welcome to the stage, Michelle Lizet Flores. Hey. Welcome to the show, Michelle.
Now, just for those who don't know, because none of y'all know, we ain't tell y'all. Each writer has a special song that plays that we felt they identify with. And so, as you can hear, that's the Trina playing Baddest Bitch. That's the, I mean, Miami. All right. So, we are going to put you now in the hot seat. Go ahead and hand that mic over to Nene. I'm going to give you this one. She's going to ask you all the questions.
So, for those who don't know, can you tell us the origins of Smelly Shelly, since, you know, Sticky Nicky is in the house?
I love it that my sister is at the show right now. So, yes. So Smelly Shelly and Sticky Nicky are two characters that I invented when I was in, like, I think it was middle school or high school. I've been writing my entire life, and that was the first real, like, book I put together. And I made it for my sister's birthday. And then it just became a thing. I had a Tumblr account, for those of you who remember what that is.
Oh, my goodness.
A deep cut, if you will. And yeah, that's where that comes from.
Okay, so earlier we mentioned What's in a Verse. Can you tell, like, our audience?
Yes, I will absolutely shamelessly plug my
open
mic.
Yes, please.
So if you all ever find yourselves in the Jacksonville, Florida on a Monday night, our doors open at 7:30. We are in historic Five Points at the Rain Dogs. And we read poems. It's a lot more like a slam event without being a slam event. So if poetry is your thing, that's the place to come every Monday night. And I run it with a lot of other really cool people who are also poetry moms in Jacksonville. So
perfect.
Y'all should come.
Thank you so much. So without further ado, we'll let you read. Again, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Michelle Lizet Flores. Yes.
This is tall girl problems right now, so let me just...
I apologize.
It's okay. Thank you. Oh, give it up for the stage tech. Thank you. Yeah. All right. So, ole y'all. All right. So as previously stated, I'm originally from the 305 Miami, Florida. Yes. And this is the first event I'm doing where my family's actually here to watch me. So shout out to this corner right here. The Hernandez family reunion is happening. So recently I started writing some short fiction, so I do apologize to the actual fiction authors here. I'm a poet by nature, learning how to write fiction, and this is the first few paragraphs of my first ever published short story called Murder Beneath the Mango Tree. Thank you. And this is based off of our great-grandmother, Arcelia. Arcelia awoke as the rooster crowed. The sun was just peering over the horizon. She stretched her arms and scratched her head as she yawned. She pulled on her dressing gown and boots, then went outside. She found the well, pumped some water into the jug, and splashed them on her face and neck. The humid heat permeated every crevice of her skin. What she would give for less fabric, she thought, as she pulled up her skirts and trudged back to the house. Even though it wasn't easy being a mother to seven before the age of 35, she loved waking her little ones up. And as she went to their rooms, she heard a frenzied knock at the door. She opened it to her neighbor, Esther, panting, not touching her belly. Then she saw the blood. "Something's wrong," Esther gasped. Arcelia brought her inside, motioning to her eldest daughter, Maritza, to bring clean towels and water. As Maritza wiped the sweat from Esther's brow, Arcelia fiddled through her collection of herbs. "Is it the pain in your back, your side, your front?" she asked while furtively looking at three different bottles of dried leaves. "Back," Esther grunted. Arcelia nodded as she poured water into a pot in the corner. She started the fire and added each herb in a specific order. "Watch," she said to Maritza as she grabbed a few leaves off a bright green tree. "Chew," she said, forcing Esther to chew until they were liquefied. As Esther swallowed, a hint of relief colored her face. Arcelia told Maritza to take the pot off the flames as she examined Esther. "This is going to hurt." Arcelia reached inside to feel the baby. "It's breech. You have to start pushing." "No," screamed Esther. "It's too early. The baby will die." Maritza considered her words carefully. "Maybe a walk? I want to see the forest, if that's okay." Ooh. My bad, y'all. I accidentally printed off the wrong pages. So we're going to stop it there. "No," screamed Esther. "It's too early. The baby will die." That's it. Okay. So if you want to finish that story, buy yourself a copy of Places We Build in the Universe. Okay. So I'm going to read some poems from my first chapbook, Gwenthels from the Swamp. And we have a tradition at my open mic when we read new shit, we yell out, "New shit." So can I hear a new shit?
New shit?
When we read old shit, we yell out old shit. So old shit. This is some old shit. So as stated before, I'm originally from Miami. And in Miami, we have this sort of archetype of a woman called a chonga. Does anybody know what that is? Yeah, y'all know. If you know, ya tú sabes. All right. So a chonga is kind of like the East Coast Caribbean version of a chola. It's like very, you know, big hoops, crunchy curly hair, wearing all the tightest clothes, looking amazing. This is Ode to a Chonga. "I saw you at Flanagan's standing near the bar waiting for your friends." That's right. Flanagan's is in poetry. You're welcome, Miami. Okay. So, "I saw you at Flanagan's standing near the bar waiting for your friends, and I thought, dale, mama, with your crunchy curly hair down to the middle of your back, with your pursed lips drinking Spanglish to anyone who'll listen, y sus uñas de acrylic fingering the hoop earrings your arms could fit through. I could see the guajira in your eyes, the way they were filled with los rayos de lumbre pura, and the beauty that José Martí depicted. So I went to holla at you, throwing down some versos sencillos, and as we stood near the end of the bar, your hips dipped to the merengue in the background. I caught you staring at my scars the way I stared at those perfect labios, and as you talked Martí, your hands moved like a lavadora, weaving that santería before I knew what hit me. I asked about the name on your breast, and when you said it was in memory of your papa, I knew the sunrises spent building condos for the gringos were worth it." Thank you. I think this time I'm gonna do some choose your own adventure. So I've got a poem about my sister. No, no shame. I've got a Thanksgiving poem, even though it's April. Who gives a shit? Time is fake. And I've got a poem about hair. What are we feeling?
Sister.
Yay! Okay. Exactly. No pressure. So this is from my second chapbook, Memoria, and this is called The Flying Flor. So my sister is right over there. Say hi, Nicole. That's Sticky Nikki, for those of you wondering. So this is called the Flying Flor. She floats suspended around the waist from our rusty swing set by the neon green jump rope I won after selling 8 boxes of the world's finest chocolate. Her deep brown hair flying around her freckled face, her lips hugging her oversized teeth while she sings her Spanish songs, arms raised, calling on the winds to pick her up and take her away. And for a moment they do, but I lose faith and there she falls, the glitter-filled rope snapping, releasing her down to the ground in a haze of terrified giggles and flailing limbs. As I run to her, she rolls over, face contorted, a fallen serif punctured by the blades of grass while Abuela scuttles outside, ammonia and brown dye number 37 dripping down her cheeks, melting her brows into hazel eyes, hands still covered by 2 big plastic gloves. She picks up the flying flor, smacks her, checks to see if she's all right, then comes after me, popping my nalgas before I have time to brace myself. I limp towards the broken jump rope as she's carried inside, the neon stretched to whiteness, dreams of greatness dashed as I realize hubris is just the lie we tell ourselves when we attempt to fly without wings. Thank you. Okay. So this one is a poem that is my take on 13 ways of seeing a blackbird. This is called 15 Ways of Looking at a Latina. And my family's going to recognize a lot of these names, so be ready for it. 15 Ways of Looking at a Latina. They call us Arcelia, treasure, altar of heaven. They call us Diosdada, determined, God-given. They call us Olga, light, holy. They call us Esther, star, myrtle leaf. They call us Xiomara, battle ready, famous in war. They call us Carmen, song, garden. They call us Milagros, miracles, marvels. They call us Muchacha, girl, maid. They call us Guapa, beautiful, bold. They call us Chonga, working class, sexually and emotionally expressive. They call us Mami, mother, sexy. They call us Pendeja, vulgar, idiot. They call us peluda, swarthy, hairy. They call us puta, prostitute, slut. They call us Latina, only if we are the right shade of brown. All right, I got 2 more for y'all. So this second one is also some old shit. Y'all are such good students. Okay, so this next one is a poem dedicated to my abuela. She was a guajira, still is a guajira. And for those of you who don't know, guajira is the Cuban Spanish word for campesina or country girl. So this is guajira trapped in the States. She leaves El Oriente because mommy says life will be better this way. So at 17, in a new country farther north than she's ever imagined, she sews. She can make everything she could never afford to buy. Hazel eyes are quickly masked by purple moons, hands that once swam through lakes now hem skirts, lips that once kissed guayabas now grip hat pins, feet that once climbed mountains now tap a pedal. Years go by, while Brooklyn stiffens her joints, Miami calls. As the seasons give way to the land where the trees don't sleep, her hands remember what her mind forgot. Guajira, with some eggshells and carrot shavings, makes the mangoes healthy once more. Where she steps, the orchids rise, growing because she gave them breath. Yet still, Miami is not home. Guajira reads her Biblia outside as the sun goes down. She drifts to sleep and dreams of her Cuba, y su finca, y su cascada. Thank you. So this is my last poem, and this is some new shit. I'm working on a new book that's all about love, which is like really uncomfortable because like a lot of feelings, right? But this is my love letter to people like y'all who take time out of your days to come to events like this and support local businesses, support local podcasts, and support local artists, because this work is really hard. And as a writer, it can be really isolating. But the fact that we're able to build community like this, no matter what state, what city we're in, I think is a really beautiful thing. So this is called A Monster by Any Other Name. A werewolf and a siren walk into a bar. At the back of the bar is a stage. A stage. On the stage is a microphone. So the werewolf and the siren take turns and they read some poems. Some of these poems are good. Some of these poems are sad. And some of these poems are funny. But all of these poems are true. The werewolf makes the siren laugh, and the siren makes the werewolf think. So the werewolf and the siren sit outside the bar, and they drink dark beer, and they smoke borrowed menthols, and they talk and talk and talk. And even though they don't seem to have much in common at first, they peel back their layers. Talons and claws and fangs pierce scale and fur and skin to reveal a bloody, pulpy center. They find they are simply two monsters longing for the moon. Thank you.
Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there? Who's there?
I'm representing for the bitches.
Can we give it up again for Lizet? Michelle Lizet Flores. I was like tearing up when I heard Flying Floor, because I actually know Flying Floor. So I was like, not right now, Denny. Hold it in.
That's the power of the poet. Right?
Yes, yes.
So before we continue on with the night, we're about to start our intermission, but we feel that it is necessary for you to tell you all who we are, for those who don't know
who we are. Who is people doing this shit?
So the Vulgar Geniuses podcast started. It started right as the world was shutting down. This was not a pandemic podcast, but it turned into one. And it was birthed out of a text message that I sent to Denny begging her to read a book by Celeste Ng because it was getting ready to be turned into a television show called Little Fires Everywhere. And so that was our very first book. And we decided that we wanted to create this book club that was going to be centered by reading books written by people of color. And as we know, we are in a stage of our world right now where books are being banned left and right. And the freedom for children to be able to read whatever they want and for adults to go into public libraries and pull things off the shelf that they feel is necessary for them is being challenged. And so for us to do what it is that we're doing today, I think that it is very important for all of us to be gathered in this room, like Michelle talked about, with the community, to be able to sit and talk and hear people who look like us and bring such good words to the stage and to the page, right?
Yes, we are very thankful to all our writers that have agreed to come to the show and bring their best to let people know who we are, what we are, and what we're capable of doing. So again, thank you all for coming to the Vulgar Geniuses Midnight Marauders Show. We're planning to continue this series. So, you know, as long as Orlando was willing to host us, we would be here.
Yes, we're hoping that we can make this a quarterly. So if you all remember us, the best way you can do that, go ahead, pull your telephone out. If you have Instagram or Twitter, go ahead. Find us, add us, put us in your daily rotation just so you know what shit we're talking about today, which is always good shit and new shit and sometimes old shit, which is always good
but
shit.
But always good shit.
Always. On that note, this is our 3-year anniversary.
Yes.
And so to celebrate, I don't have enough for everybody, but I brought y'all some cupcakes.
We have
so
cupcakes.
We got that Public cupcake. You know, that buttercream.
Yes.
That buttercream.
From Publix.
So I brought vanilla because I don't know what everybody has. I wish I could have gotten
vegan. That's her
favorite,
though.
But this shit cost a lot of money. This would be like $10 for a cupcake. So if you want, I have them over here. Don't be ashamed. Come on up. I can walk around. You can raise your hand like I'll be your waitress for tonight. Get you a cupcake. Help us celebrate. And then we'll be bringing up our last two readers of the night. Sounds good? All right. Rubot's going to take us away. Y'all enjoy the music. All right, Stardust. We're getting ready to start the second of our half of our show. So if you could kindly find your seats.
Thank you so much. We have two more very, 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 very excellent writers coming up on the stage.
That's right. In 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Thank you. All right. So now that you all have been sugared up and liquored up, we can start with the rest of our show. The next guest that we have coming up is none other than Kayla Kumari Upadhyaya. Woo! Oh, we see who brought the house today.
Yes.
She is a lesbian writer of essays, short stories, and pop culture criticism living in Orlando. She is the author of Helen House, a queer horror novelette. Woo-hoo. She is the managing editor of Auto Straddle and the assistant managing editor at Tri-Quarterly. Please put your hands together for Kayla!
Kayla!
Give me body, body.
Look at her.
Y'all see this dress? This dress is so pretty.
I tried to match the theme, you know?
But people want details on your dress. Can you tell them where your dress is from?
It's like the red carpet.
who put you together today?
I want to thank myself and myself.
All right, so these questions are going to be coming from me this evening. All right, so if you win Miss America, no. I mean, you're already dressed for it. All right, so this past December, your partner, Kirsten Arnett, decided she wanted to upgrade you and put a ring on it. Congratulations on the engagement. So I was just curious, did you just announce it, like, you know, with that one post that you have on Instagram with your finger and the ring? Or before you posted that, did you come up with different ways to show your friends, like, hey, girl, how you doing? Something happened in my life. Like, how did you let the world know that you were going to become an honest woman?
Yeah, normally I would have like a coordinated social media launch, but I genuinely was so surprised that I had no plans. That was like just organic. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, there was no plan.
Nice. But you can still do that now. Even though I'm like, won't you come on over, check my outfit? All right, next question. You are forever, and I love it every time. It makes my heart so happy, posting the most delicious food and cocktails in your stories. What is your go-to meal and drink when you are working on the piece that you are writing?
Ooh, so when I'm like deep writing a project, I usually am not cooking. I'm getting delivery, and it's probably Domino's.
Not du jour, no.
And I'm probably drinking Fernet.
Nice. I have to come to your house. So congratulations on the recent release of Helen House, which you have described as a queer horror novelette. What was the inspiration behind this book?
Good question. I like lesbians and ghosts. And
that's a good mix.
Yeah.
That's all you need, right? That's all you need to make the perfect story. And I'm assuming you are going to read us an excerpt of that tonight.
Yes.
All right. Everybody in the place, put your hands together for Kayla.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. This is so exciting. I'm very excited to be here. I've only read from this book twice before now, so this will be the third time. It's called Helen House. It's a novelette, which for anyone who doesn't know, is shorter even than a novella, something I learned after I wrote it. So I'm going to read the beginning of it and then a very short part from the middle. I don't know if it's the beginning, but this is where I'll start. 2 weeks before I met her parents, Amber said she had something important to tell me. Her timing wasn't great. I just slipped my tongue in her open mouth, and it sounded like she was speaking into a cave, damp, swallowed words, her teeth scraping my tongue. It felt good. All I could hear was important and tell you. Can it wait? I asked, pinching off her bra. It fell to the floor, she kissed me, and I thought, that's that. It was the start of a new semester, and our schedules were mucked up to the point sex had become a weekend-only activity. But on that particular Monday, we found ourselves with a rare pocket of nothing. No work, no plans, nothing. I'd returned home from a jog immensely horny and texted Amber, assuming she'd be busy. I need you, I typed, and then deleted. I need you in my mouth, I texted instead. We'd only been together a year, too early for sex to dwindle, but I was putting off raising that concern. I worried what else it might kick up. We kept kissing, and I opened my eyes, a habit Amber and every girl I've ever been with hates, but what's so wrong with wanting to see someone? I love looking at the ugly, open wound of someone's kissing mouth. From that close, everyone looks the same. Before I'd ever been kissed with living lips, I kissed every surface I could find, the top of my desk at school, the handle of my bedroom door, magazines I stole from my sister's room that smelled like her friends, the fruity scents of their body sprays soured by sweat. Sometimes I'd perch on top of the bathroom sink and make out with my own reflection in the mirror, always with my eyes open, tonguing the cold, hard surface. I liked to pretend. I learned it from my sister. Late at night, when we were supposed to be asleep, I'd sneak into her room so she could tell me ghost stories. It started when we were very young. She'd just started reading big girl chapter books, and I was jealous, always wishing I could fast forward time. She had a collection of fairy tales, and she read them over and over to me. Hansel and Gretel was her favorite. She said we were like the fabled siblings, casting me as the brother, which I didn't mind. But we got sick of the repetition, and one night she started making up stories instead of reading them, a kind gift to soothe my jealousy. But once more, I was jealous, this time of her gift for storytelling. She was so good at it. The world she concocted out of thin air were wondrous and alive, and I tricked myself into believing that maybe one day I could go to them. My sister saw things other people couldn't, other worlds calling to us. In my favorite ghost story of hers, I was the protagonist, a ghost who played strange pranks on mean girls from our neighborhood. I loved this spirit version of myself. She was, except for being dead, exactly who I wanted to be. Tough and smart and in control of her own life. When I tongued the mirror, I didn't imagine another human on the other side. I imagined I was kissing my own ghost. Amber tasted like pickles that Monday, and I wondered what she'd eaten for lunch, was aroused by the sour smell and taste. I liked that she didn't bother to brush her teeth before coming over. I suddenly wanted every bit of her all at once. The sunset inked the bedroom walls deep orange, and shards of light burst in the reflection of Amber's glasses. I slid my hands off her hips and reached for her face. She pulled back so quickly I almost fell forward. No, she said, we have to talk now. My hands, which had been seconds away from removing her glasses, hovered between us awkwardly. Shoot, I said. There's something I haven't told you about my parents. My first thought was that she'd lied to me about being out to her parents, something I could probably deal with but wasn't ideal. I liked secrets, but I didn't want to be one. But it wasn't that. I didn't fully register what she'd said at first. I was still thinking about her pickled breath. I was still thinking about open mouths and the things that spill out of them. I suddenly wished I could place my hand over her mouth while I fucked her into nightfall, hot breath and spit dampening my palm. I had a sister, Amber said. She died on a family camping trip when I was 6 and she was 4, drowned. It was, to say the least, not at all what I expected. It was, to say the least, strange timing. She was topless, I was still tightly wound with arousal. You might think a dead sister is an instant mood killer, but I'm always my stupidest when horny, and my mind was slow to shift gears in that bizarre and decidedly unsexy moment. She delivered the words as if they were scripted. Carefully memorized and wrote, unfeeling. I said nothing. I wondered if I might be dreaming, touched her wrist as if that could provide an answer. Her skin was ice cold. She shivered at my touch, and I decided it wasn't a dream at all. Strange timing in fucking deed. There were plenty of times she could have mentioned her dead sister. Like, for example, when I'd told her about my dead sister. Like, for Lucy, my funny and loud sister who loved cheeseburgers and listening to the scores of movies she'd never seen and making up ghost stories that were as romantic as they were terrifying. Lucy, who once had sore legs for 3 days because she'd spent so many hours bending over to collect seashells at the beach. Lucy, who died when she was 32 and I was 26. 4 years ago, but I prefer to count the time in days, like an astronaut lost in space, dictating a diary so they don't go completely insane. 1,464 days since contact with Mission Control. 1,464 days since my big sister died alone in a car accident. I looked at Amber and her outline blurred, the room fogged over as if someone had let the outside in. The lowering sun bruised the walls purple now. The room looked dark and I felt swallowed by it. I closed my eyes and reopened them, but the fog lingered. "It's okay," Amber said, "I'm okay." I still hadn't spoken. A phantom fingertip drew a line down my face and I realized it was a tear. I dabbed at my face with my wrists and Amber came into focus. She thought I was crying for her dead sister, not mine. "Why didn't you tell me?" I asked. Guilt hit as soon as the words left my mouth. I knew I was making it about me when really this belonged to her, Amber's life, Amber's loss. I slid my hand over the thin scar on her shoulder. I'd noticed it the first time we slept together, but never asked about it, never even wondered, really. I didn't see the point of explaining old wounds. "I don't like to talk about it," Amber said. I nodded. The space between us couldn't have been more than a foot, but it felt vast in the growing darkness. I pulled her in for a hug. She was so icy, and for a moment I thought I might not be able to focus again, might be back to thinking about all the ways I wanted to make her body warm, to make it quake. She sniffled, and I released her. But she wasn't crying. She stood there, half naked, studying me, perhaps trying to actually read my mind, since I still wasn't offering much by way of words. I took her hand and pulled her to the bed. We sat on its edge, our shoulders touching. It was hard not to think of my dead sister. It was hard not to think of all the ways I was a bad girlfriend. The former was a near constant, and the latter had become a recurring theme. Just a few days earlier, I'd written a list in my journal, quite literally labeled, "Reasons I'm a Bad Girlfriend." A past therapist had gotten me into the habit of making lists. Though to be fair, I think she had intended for it to be more of a grounding technique than an exercise in self-loathing. "My parents are going to talk about it when you see them," Amber said. She spoke softly to the wall in front of us, and I watched her lips. "I had to tell you before a trip." "Okay," I said. "At the top of the list, I don't know if I love her. Under that, in smaller script, haha, what is love?" "They talk about it a lot," Amber told the wall. "They never really got over it." "How could they?" I asked. "I meant it. My parents split after Lucy died. The divorce was good for them. They were more functional in its aftermath. They were still both people who had lost a daughter, sure, so forever changed, never exactly who they were before. But my mother cried less after the divorce. My father joined a grief group and made friends for the first time in his adult life. When they were together, their combined pain choked them silent. They barely spoke to me or anyone. So I welcomed their split. Somehow it made more sense to explode the family once Lucy was gone than to try to piece anything together. When my sister died, I died too. Not a piece of me, as another therapist gently suggested, the whole me. I became my ghost self on the other side of the mirror, the one who felt nothing, who could only stare back passively. She drowned, Amber said. I didn't point out she was repeating herself. I looked at Amber's mouth, her lips parted and soft, and I imagined it filling with water, choking her, spilling out into the room and swallowing us up. I saw it so clearly, I may as well have been dreaming. I once agreed to go with my father to his support group. It wasn't just for fathers who'd lost children, as I'd believed before. All kinds of mourners were present. Widows, widowers, old folks whose friends were dying in waves, people with ghosts for siblings, friends, cousins, lovers. There were so many kinds of death. A bereavement mix pack, I joked in the car after, and I was pleased when my dad laughed, a rare sound from this man who was quiet even before Lucy died. At the meeting, I found myself relating most to the widowers. When these men talked about their gone wives, I thought about my sister. They kept talking about the feeling of coming home to an empty house, of turning on lights, expecting to see their wives sprung back from the dead. One man said he'd leave on faucets just to feel like someone else was in the house, would fill a tub with water and never get in. Another said he'd found a video online of a woman going through her morning routine, washing her face, putting on makeup, brushing her teeth, no commentary at all, just ambient getting ready sounds, ASMR crap. But for him, an escape hatch. He confessed he put it on every morning. Empty houses. I hadn't lived with Lucy since we were children, and yet I knew exactly what these men were talking about. Spaces felt either too big or too small, the proportions of my home wonderlanded and wrong. I was always flipping on light switches, hoping the shadows would take on new shape. Lucy didn't live with me when we were adults, yet she was always there with me in the apartment, chattering away on FaceTime while I cooked fish curry, helping me pick out what to wear on dates, texting me strings of missives from the various jobs she worked, most of them outside because Lucy wasn't an indoor kid like me. She liked dirt and trees and collecting parts of the earth, seashells and rocks and bleached animal bones. She didn't have to literally be inside my house for me to feel like she was always there, always a text away, always inside. Yes, I understood these men and the pain of empty houses. We were not the same, and yet we were knotted together. Thank you.
Okay, I gotta read that story. Give me some ghost stories.
Come on.
All right.
When it comes to lyrics, I bring them. In spring, I sing and fall. I call out to all the ones.
All right. We are at the end of our program, but at the beginning of our relationship together. This has been wonderful. It's been a wonderful walk this evening. Before we get into that, I just want to do just a quick little promo first. If you like to read, if you want to be a member of our book club, we have four amazing books. We try to rotate through different sets of books every month, giving people options to choose. And for our anniversary month, we have one book that is called Dyscalculia by Kimone Felix. She is an amazing queer poet who has written a memoir about a very bad breakup, and she pieces it together with her mental disorder of dyscalculia. If you've never heard of it, I think you should go out and pick up this book. It is truly phenomenal. Saints of the Household by Ari Tenson. If you are one who is into YA, this is an indigenous story about two young men, boys who are trying to navigate their world in high school and a lot of things that go on in there. She is a Haunting, which is another queer story, YA that deals with haunting, that is by a writer named Train Tran. And then we have our fiction of the month is Drinking from Graveyard Wells, which is our first Zimbabwe writer. Her name is Yvette Lisa Nuovo. So if you are into any of that or anything that we put out, if you want to join us and talk on Zoom about what we're reading, or if you haven't read anything and you just want to come in and just talk to us, we're welcome to that. You know, we'll talk. As you can see, that's what we're doing right now.
Or if you just want to listen to the episodes, so when we talk to these authors, they're all everywhere where you find your podcasts.
Yes.
So for our finale.
Our finale. This is a special moment for me because this particular writer is probably the reason why all of you all are here. And I'm so grateful that he has agreed to come up and you know, help build community with us and read his work. So let's welcome up to the stage none other than Ryan Rivas.
Ryan, Ryan. For those that who don't know yet, Ryan Rivas is the author of Next Door in Colonial Town and Lizard People 30 West forthcoming in fall 2023. He is the publisher of Borough Press and the coordinator of MFA Publishing at Stetson University MFA of the Americas Creative Writing Program. I'm a Condo Writers Workshop Fellow. His work has appeared in The Believer, The Rumpus, Literary Hub, Best American Non-Required Reading 2012, and elsewhere. Again, Ryan Rivas, everybody. Woohoo! So, you know, since most of the people here know that you like taking pictures of houses, of things, of buildings, what is the most haunting picture you've taken of a house?
The most haunting picture, oh my goodness. Maybe like the Amway Arena. For several reasons. Before it was destroyed, and then also the ownership group is they're haunting us to this day.
To this day. There's a follow-up. Do you think someone has been standing in your front, the front of your house, taking photos of your own house?
I kind of hope so. I would encourage that kind of behavior.
Being that next book.
You are the man of many hats behind Borough Press. You are the publisher, the editor, the candlestick maker. What has it been like for you to take on the goal of bringing Orlando a publishing house that has been dedicated to collaborating with writers and creatives all over Florida?
What has it been like? It's been crazy, as you know. It's like a labor of love. It takes people coming out. Supporting each other, writers volunteering to do the sound or film or, you know, or edit something, you know. It takes a village, which is a cliche. But also, you know this because this is what you're doing right now, too. So rather than what I was going to say in the intro before I read, maybe I'll just do this now and say it takes a lot of labor of love to, like, put on an event, to create a podcast, and to do it at such a level. And so maybe we should all give Veronica and Denny a round of applause, too, for that. Because this is honestly, like, the best thing I've seen in a long time in Orlando in terms of events, and I'm really happy to be here. So.
Well, we're happy that you are a part of it.
No offense to other events.
So your last question. If you have a friend to submit a manuscript for publishing, and it was trash, how would you turn them down, let them know?
Thank you for submitting manuscript to Borough Press. We were excited to read it, and unfortunately it is not a good fit for us at this time. We wish you the best of luck placing this manuscript in the future.
Auto reply. All right, well, without further ado, get ready. Get your eyes and your ears ready for this wonderful writer. Put your hands together for Ryan.
I brought slides because once you do a image textbook, you can't lower the bar. You have to have images all the time, at least in my brain, so. I'm going to read from a novelette that's coming out in the fall called Lizard People. When the time comes for pre-orders, I'll suddenly become insufferable or more insufferable than usual, so you'll know about how to get it. Lizard People is set in potentially in a time where there are no more plantation weddings. I'm going to read the first three sections, but I'm going to intersperse it with a document that appears towards the end, which is a proposal to create a new category in the DSM 5 or 8 or whatever it is in this future that's sort of somewhere in the future. New shit. Thank you. Also, although I have lived in Orlando for several years, I am 305 hasta la muerte. So. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. I went to the coast for immersion therapy. I told my cube mate it was for the humid air, for my lungs. But when I arrived at the resort, the weather was abnormally cold and dry. Only Karen knew the truth. On the day of the trip, she'd found me in the copy room with my face pressed to the warm glass, dewlap untucked from my Oxford. Karen had always been a discreet coworker. She'd witnessed an incident the month prior and had taken my side for the official report, but she didn't know that I had since been referred to a specialist, hence my trip to the coast. I explained everything, and she seemed to understand. She laughed, though not in a cruel way. "You're a strange one," she said, "but you're pure." The hug was as pleasant as it was unexpected. We had not so much as shaken hands until that moment. "Whatever they're selling you," she said, mid-embrace, "don't buy it." And with that, I left the windowless office in the city for the resort. Blue skies, blue ocean, palms waving hesitantly like one does to a stranger they've mistaken for a friend. There was a chill in the air, but it was nice in the sun, by the pool, and the other poolgoers didn't seem to mind my appearance. Perhaps people were more open-minded on the coast. And given the demographics that have rendered whiteness normative are no longer operative, the time has come to re-examine a pathology long acknowledged by professionals, but obstructed from official diagnosis by centuries of national hegemony. Building on the work of Soloway and Dunbar, see Soloway and Dunbar, Appendix 3, whose groundbreaking correlations between prejudice and mental illness have set the stage for a broad re-examination of professional terminology, there has been renewed interest in the clinical studies related to the pathology of whiteness. Indeed, there is much ground to cover and myriad nuances to explore. This paper seeks to revise two specific diagnoses. The authors have identified a sizable cohort of patients who exhibit characteristics indicative of dissociative fugue and psychogenic amnesia, see Appendix 4. While a broad range of traumas are associated with these diagnoses, the authors have established that this cohort's dissociative symptoms stem from a singular causal origin, a confrontation with one's own whiteness. Early studies suggest the primary catalyst for this distinct type of dissociation is rooted in feelings of guilt and overwhelming responsibility for prejudice, be it mild or extreme, personal or systemic, active participation or passive complicity, resulting in a spectrum of responses from denial to delusion. Symptoms include verbal denial, memory loss, and in the most extreme cases, identity reinvention. These are some weird images I found on Public Domain Review. I think they resonate. The latest therapist said hypnosis would help me access memories as early as infancy. I lay on his couch in the dark office, eyes closed, overcome with feelings of warmth and serenity. As he counted down from 10, light seemed to flood the room, and when I opened my eyes, I was not supine on a therapist's couch, but staring at the mobile in my childhood bedroom. Stars and birds and cotton ball clouds hung from string and spun in slow circles. I'd brought language with me to describe these objects that, at 6 months old, I could have only absorbed as shapes and colors, sounds and smells. Mother's song drifting down the hallway, crisp and clear. Blossom of snow, may you bloom and grow. The smell of bacon in the kitchen. Morning, the morning light dappled on the ceiling, interrupted by mother's pale face, so young and free of wrinkles, her blue eyes specked with black flakes. She reached into the crib to lift me, her long fingers outstretched and tipped with dark claws. These aren't real glasses, don't worry. The authors argue these symptoms require special consideration separate from their existing diagnoses under current categories. Such dissociative symptoms should be outgrowths of the pending category of whiteness. The authors suggest the subcategorical term dissociative whiteness to clearly differentiate between varieties of denial associated with other conditions. As such, existing treatments for recognized dissociative disorders, while instructive, are not sufficient. The challenge of treatment lies in patients' denial of the underlying pathology, which itself is characterized by symptoms of denial, creating a compound pathology akin to what some cross-disciplinary scholars have termed epistemologies of ignorance. See Mills, Appendix 3. The authors report difficulty establishing a baseline from which patients have deviated and to which they may safely return to begin addressing core underlying identity issues. Patients who cannot or refuse to understand the underlying pathology prove less responsive to treatment. Based on extensive research, interviews, controlled experiments, and various therapeutic methods, the authors have identified three types of denial related to dissociative whiteness, with responses to treatment varying based on each patient's understanding of their core pathological identity. One, enlightened denial. Memory loss tends to be temporary and brief. Patients exhibit firm, if uneasy, understanding of core identity. Condition is often triggered by, quote, ambush. See Yancey, Appendix 3. Traditional talk therapy sufficient for treatment. Two, compound denial. Sustained memory loss. Fugue state is common and prolonged. Condition is often triggered by an unconscious incident of prejudice made conscious, usually through confrontation. Patients exhibit little to no understanding of core identity. Intense treatment beyond traditional CBT required. Three, delusional denial. Memory loss, alteration, invention, and replacement. Complete identity reinvention. Condition appears to correlate with exposure to extremist identity groups. Additional symptoms resemble monomaniacal zoanthropy with elements of clinical lycanthropy. Experimental treatments in progress. See Appendix 3. Over the course of several years, the authors have compiled hundreds of case studies, though many treatments remain ongoing, particularly in acute. I walked the grounds of the resort accompanied by a nurse. My companion and I strolled in full sun along a wide pedestrian path lined with palms. The sand-dusted concrete followed the coastline within earshot of the waves. "It's cold here," I said. The nurse nodded. "Supposed to be colder tomorrow. I may need to lay out again soon." "That's fine, but let's keep walking for now." At some point, the path left the resort grounds and passed through a neighborhood of bungalows, low and flat. Staked into the grass of each yard were bright red signs with bold white letters reading, "No Destiny." "No destiny?" I said. "No density," the nurse said. "It says destiny." Must be a typo. People can read entire paragraphs of mangled grammar without losing the gist. The nurse chuckled. "The mind sees what it wants to see." "I see," I said. "But what does it mean?" "Oh," the nurse said. "It's part of an ongoing anti-development campaign from before the resort. The locals don't want more people, more cars, or any more traffic in the neighborhood." "Invasive species," I said. "Something like that," the nurse said. We paused where the path curved away from the coast and into town, where the palms gave way to oaks and shade. The nurse crouched down to meet my gaze. "Would you like to keep going?" he asked. "I think I'd like to go back now." "Okay," the nurse said. "Can we try it on two legs this time?" Thank you.
Thank you all so much. I'm trying hard not to cry. This is amazing. It gives me something to tell my mama too when I go home.
Same.
Thank y'all for coming out. Thank you to all of the readers. Please give yourselves a big applause for coming out and showing community. Give a round of applause Rubox. To our DJ Rubox.
Rubox.
Please give another round of applause to our producer and sound man of the evening, Preston Long.
friend.
Hello, friend.
We did it, friend.
We did it.
We did it. Group shot real quick. I want everybody. I'm going to do this. Thank y'all. Be safe. Be well. Stay always reading. And we'll catch you on the podcast. Good night.
We hope you enjoyed our show.
Our show has been produced and edited by Preston Long. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe to our podcast.
Our theme song you've been nodding your head to is by Sean Kantrowitz. You can follow him on Twitter and Instagram at Sean Dammit. That's SeanDammit.
Follow us on Instagram at The Vulgar Geniuses.
Bye!